in our contemporary European society is what is called the proof of causation. Something causes something to happen. The pen moves because she causes it to move through her will, through her hand, through her mind. Something causes everything to happen in creation. And people can understand then that there is a principle of causation. Now some people will say, but it was all random. It just happened. The earth just went boom and there. Okay, but that's not the way that we see it. We actually understand causation that leads us backwards and backwards and backwards to something that causes the creation in the first place. So I think this is a useful way of talking about it. And the third thing I want, sir.
Yeah, so about that, how was the people who are believing in Big Bang and all this stuff?
Yeah.
How to convince them?
Because there had to be something that banged. Okay?
Well, there are some crazy people who are believing that something which is undone can be done.
Yeah.
So,
this is not an argument that is always going to be possible to win. You know, there are some very intelligent people in our society who know all these arguments and say, I'm not convinced. Mm-hmm. So be it.
For this type of people, we can't do anything?
Live the message, that's all. I think, you know. Because if it were simply a question of finding a good philosophical argument, the philosophers would have done it. Well, no, we've very clever philosophers around, but we've also very clever people who have looked at all those arguments and they're not convinced.
Like the scientists, for example.
Some of them. But very interesting, many scientists, as time goes on, they have gone through a stage of saying, we can explain everything, and now many scientists are coming to a stage that say, we can't explain things here. Yeah. Well, no. Many more scientists are now, as it were, putting God into their science.
Without using the word, actually.
Without using the word often. But there are many things that we can't explain. We have a scientific literalism as well. Mm-hmm. No? Just because the scientist says it's true, it must be true. Mm-hmm. Nonsense. Good scientists know that all their ideas, their theories, are worked out as what we would say propositions. This is a good way of talking about it, a good way of explaining it.
I think so. It's really important for us to remember that we're not trying to change their belief, we're trying to explain to them our belief. And I think that you're not trying to tell them that you're wrong.
Yes, we're asking people to respect us for what we believe, not necessarily to change what they believe. And that's important principle. And it therefore is sufficient to finish by saying, well, my arguments convince me. You're quite entitled not to be convinced.
Can give them food for thought.
Exactly. The final thing I think is important in our European context is what kind of a God is it that you are trying to prove that exists? You see, because the European concept of God has been very much what I call God the Great Policeman. God is watching, God notices everything you do. You cannot escape God, and you will be punished. Is that the kind of God that we are trying to explain to people? Because people have an immediate reaction against that. So it is interesting, you needn't do it now, but you can do it on the way home. Try to write out, literally to write out in a sentence or two, what you mean when you use the term God or Allah. Is it a heavenly policeman? What exactly is it that you're trying to explain to people? I did it. So I can ask you to do it. God is that unique source, flow, and goal of life, goodness, love, and truth. That's my sentence. God is that unique source and flow and goal of life, goodness, love, and truth. That's quite different from a heavenly policeman. So think it through. What is it that you're trying? Okay. And finally, in this section, how will God judge non-Muslims and those from a non-religious background? The first thing to say is, it's not your business. That's God's business. Alhamdulillah. You are not to sit in ultimate judgment on any other human being. You should be very thankful for that. Only God is the ultimate judge. It's God's business. Our problem in the present Muslim world, in this takfiri generation, is precisely the problem of shirk. Because if you are takfiri, you are condemning people and putting yourself in the position of God. I am able to judge, you are going to hell. Who are you? You think you're God? Second, what kind of God is God? God is just. You can say nothing more profound than that. It would be fundamentally unjust to judge human beings on something that they do not know. There is a speed limit on that road. If you break it, you will go to prison. But I'm not going to tell you what the speed limit is. That is fundamentally unjust. Therefore, God will not, cannot, it would be against God's nature to judge human beings on what they do not know. So the human being who has never encountered the Quran, the Prophet, the tradition and life of Islam, cannot be judged on the Quran, the Prophet, and the tradition and life of Islam. They can be judged on what they do know. They may know an earlier revelation, they may be Ahl Kitab in its broadest sense, which includes the Hindus of India, or it may be that they have lost contact with their earlier revelation, but they still have their natural human goodness, their intellect, and therefore they should live by that natural way of life in order to live a good life. God will judge them on what they know. Please.
Sometimes we are being told that in these days, actually, with the internet and everything, with the number of books we have, and that they're accessible to everyone, actually, so they cannot ignore that there is, there are a lot of religions, and that Islam also exists, and that, well, we have been told sometimes that it is, well, anyway, it is the right path, like, for us anyway. So they should
be knowing about that, because now it's, we can't say that Islam is hidden or anything. It's so open to everyone, and sometimes in a really bad way, but it's open, so they actually can know about it. Mm. So when you say that they can't be judged mm. on something they don't know, then shouldn't they be knowing in a sense?
Shouldn't they be taking the action to know it?
Perhaps.
That would apply to that portion of humankind that has access to the internet, let's say.
Yeah.
Remember, that certainly isn't everybody.
Yeah.
Okay. First of all, certainly, our intellect should prompt us to struggle for greater and greater access to the truth. And we should go and seek it. That's part of being human. There is, however, a problem. And that is, what kind of Islam do you encounter that way? You will know that there are thousands of internet sites that look as though they come from the world of Islam. Many of them, most of them, are coming from extremist groups.
That's true.
You know, those people present who are computer literate, you could run 10 websites from your bedroom on your own at night without any problem. And you could make every one of them look as though they were really genuine Islam. That's one of our problems. So we cannot blame people who are encountering what we would have to call a false understanding of Islam. That's important, and that's an awful lot of people in society. There is, however, a further challenge behind your question, and it is the challenge that I personify. As you already have got the impression, I know a little bit about Islam. No? 30 years of studying it, I know a little bit about Islam. And I am not sitting in a place of neutrality, but I am deliberately choosing to follow that path of Christianity into which I was born and which I deliberately choose still to follow in spite of all the knowledge of Islam that I have accumulated. Now, there is a challenge here. It's a challenge for Muslims to think through. Is this man a super kafir? Because you need to know something to be a kafir.
Yeah?
If you're going to cover something up, you need to know something to cover it. And if you know a lot, you need a cover the size of a mountain. So is this man a super kafir? Or is it possible that we have to say that God is capable of calling human beings to follow different paths that lead to God even after the coming of the final revelation and the final prophet? Please do not answer immediately, because it means you've not thought about it. It's a really problematic question. Because, as you say, you know, the typical Islamic discourse has been when Imam al-Mahdi comes, when Jesus comes, they will return. In other words, that they will return, and I'm saying something different. And that is it possible without denying that we've gone astray throughout this length of time, that there could be another extant path? Sheikh has an answer.
I just want to give something on the Mahdiism aspect, not on anything preceding that. And that is, we have texts to say that when Mahdi comes, he will govern the Jews with the Torah, and the Christians with the Injil, and the Muslims with the Quran. And this is a known, given text. On that basis, it suggests, and he will govern them, and get the best out of them through their own text, their own given context. If it's good enough for Mahdi to do, and by virtue good enough for the Prophet to have done in Medina, to allow another faith to yield goodness through their own text, I find it incomprehensible that a Muslim would say anything other than what the example comes from their Prophet and the Imam of their time.
Thank you very much. Islamic thought framework. Because we have to say, do we not, that Jesus and the Injil were actually bearing witness to something different from the way in which Christianity has developed that message. Huh? That's the problem. So the problem is not, would pure Christianity based on Jesus and the Injil be acceptable in the time of Imam al-Mahdi and therefore today? But what about what Christians believe today? That's the problem. Please.
There are so many other religions. What about Hinduism?
Well,
yeah. So you're excluding everybody.
No,
else?
I'm not excluding them at all. I'm just saying that's another chapter, and that's another day.
Okay.
I just pose that because it's really important to think this through in our European context, because people want to know, well, what are you saying about them? Not about me, I mean, super kafir, that's fine.
Do you have a minute to answer the question about justice? What you said, God is just?
Yes.
I have people who have lost babies and children, small ages.
Yeah.
And they say, God is so unjust. They can't. How do you explain that? Because when you say we've got intellect and reasoning, how do you explain a child that's dead? And, you know, grandmother, 100-year-old people are still alive and 6-year-old kids are just dying. How do you explain that?
First of all, I would say that we live in a universe which, by definition, cannot be perfect. God alone is perfect. Secondly, our task as Khalifa is to struggle against those imperfections in the world. That's why our medical men and women are struggling to overcome illnesses and so on. We have come a huge long way. Think back to your grandmother. How many babies did your grandmother lose by comparison with how many babies has your daughter lost? Huge.
Well, it could be an accident.
Huge step. So,
I want to just jump on what you say
about
the perfection and the imperfection. God is perfect, right? How can you explain somebody perfect, how can it create something imperfect?
Yeah.
You understand?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
And the way that we would answer is to say, the perfection of God, one of the perfections of God is that God is beyond time and beyond space. By definition, the creation is inside time, inside space. Therefore, God never gets older. I get older. You will one day get older. When you get older, you do not function as well as you did when you get younger. No. Huh? It's a natural consequence of time. The earth is X million years old. Don't ask me what the X is. Therefore, things change, things develop. It is stuck in time. It is naturally imperfect because it is fixed in time. It will decay. It will end, like me. Therefore, God alone is the only perfection, and everything outside of God, that includes the creation, can only be as perfect as is possible, given that it's created in time and space.
I would come back again on that. I mean, is this is not a kind of injustice to be to accept that we have been created imperfect from someone who is himself perfect?
Yeah. Given that I am not God, we are creatures of God, and we are not God, we therefore necessarily have that imperfection of being a creature, fixed in time and space. Otherwise, God would create another God.
I mean, our imperfection is intrinsic. I mean, intrinsic.
Intrinsic.
Yeah.
It's intrinsic to our creature nature. But human beings are not just creature nature. We also have a higher nature. So you remember that the Quran talks about, and God took the earth and formed Adam and Eve, and into them blew the spirit. Now this blowing of the spirit then is the higher dimension of what it is to be human. We can call it our soul, our intellect, that which enables me as a creature to have a spiritual relationship with God, who is all spirit. So this is the bit that allows me to make that relationship. And I am in the process of growing in perfection, in purity and in wisdom, not just in this life, but in the life hereafter. And here's the crucial bit, but I am coming ever closer to the infinity, the infinite goodness of God. Now mathematicians will know infinity minus one is still infinity. In other words, you can never ever get there. So there is always this progression, because we remain creatures. I am not God.
But I think the only religion is Islam. So.
Okay. Yes, this is